Now we're visible to the internet. Scary. Oh my gosh. Oh, I need to change everyone's thing.
Really sucks. I can't see anybody's face. Except you, honey. Which is, I
really?
See your face all the time.
It's
yeah,
probably because no. I was the last one talking and you're on mobile, so I think what it'll do, it'll take precedent.
That. Like, no, it just says unstable connection. My phone, like,
yeah,
I think
yeah, mine, everyone's freezing on my end, too.
Yeah, you're frozen right now.
Of course.
Yeah, your camera is frozen.
And there's a cat.
Dun dun dun. That's our elevator music.
Yes, as I accept it. Because, like, Discord will change where everyone pops up in the grid for me, so then I have to change my little name tags. For
yeah. I was like, the fact that you keep up with that is, like, amazing. Like, because we all, like, switch our cameras on.
I know, and I'm like, stop switching your cameras on. That's fine.
Yay.
We're all good. We are so professional here. It's,
so professional. As I'm laying down in my bedroom.
Rue was like, I want to recline.
I mean, I'm wearing a fucking work shirt with no bra on. What is professional?
Oh no,
this
Rue and Sophia, your cameras are frozen.
But oh, his. I can see all y'all.
Yeah. Me too.
Yeah.
I look fine.
Well, according to the stream, Sophia is kind of frozen like this. And Rue is looking down at something. So.
Down, yeah. That's what I see. That's so strange.
Yeah.
Mercury, why?
So I don't know if you want to try and
drop
and re-add. I don't know if we lost you completely, Sophia. Video is frozen.
I'm here.
Ah, I see.
Hang on.
And then there were two.
I know. Tired.
What have you been up to
today?
And then today has actually been a very, like, doing stuff day for me. I have a decent amount of things ready for the shop for South Jersey Bacon Pride. So that's what I was doing this morning. Oh my god. Anyway, little bat flaps after. So self-conscious. Anyway, so we
I almost had a whole nip slip.
Oh yeah, you did almost have a whole nip slip.
Why though?
Yeah, both of your cameras are now not loading up at all. I don't know. We might just not have video on you two for this episode. So maybe it's because you two are on mobile and Discord doesn't like that today. Because I know, Scott, you're on your laptop, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So we're both on a computer, so I don't know if Discord's just being a pain in the ass to mobile users today.
Who knows? It's always a bit of a bastard to Rue and I, where we can't see each other, and it always just says unstable internet.
Yeah, like, I pay for, like, fucking gigabit home internet. I should.
I know, we both have really good internet. It makes no sense.
I think it's Discord.
Jay, can you at least see me so the stream can?
No, I can't see either of you right now.
I can see neither you
it's
nor
okay.
Rue.
It's fine.
Yeah,
I will exist in the void as a state of gas.
If anything, I would just turn your camera off so that way your little icon shows, and then the audio quality will be better.
Cool. I can recline. Bye, y'all.
There you go, and you can slip all the nips that you want because you don't have a camera on. So there you go.
Slut!
Nip slip.
Yo, we'll get my,
this is a chaotic.
Get my silent contribution this episode.
This is a chaotic episode.
Yeah, but that's okay. Things usually are. It's kind of like, speaking of chaos, Pagan Pride was last weekend. This is sort of my, like, I guess I use this episode, whatever the episode that comes after Pagan Pride, is my decompressing therapy session post-event fucking therapy session for those that shared information about protest groups and whatnot. I appreciate you and thank you for telling us that, but we were protester free this year. Applause. Golf clap. Yeah, protester free. There were the thing that we had the most problem with was a bunch of these vendors that didn't have permits, you know, like they're just unlicensed vendors that are there like every weekend kind of thing. And we had a permit through Parks and Rec for the park for the day, and so we were like, hey, we're like setting up here in this space, and they were like, oh well, no one told us, you know, just the fucking Philly fucking attitude that people have. Well, I'm here every fucking weekend. Yeah, well, I have a fucking permit for today, so scoot your ass down, bro.
So we had it's the same thing up here. People just act entitled to a space because they want to occupy it. It has nothing to do with like who actually has the right to it. Like when we were filming in an area that we had rented out, we'd ask people politely not to, and they'd be like, well, it's a public space, so I think I will. Thank you. And
right. They're just complete.
I really don't get it.
Yeah, just complete cocksuckers about it. You're like, you got to be like that? Okay, cool. But fortunately, that helped.
Technically, I can't tell you no, but you're a dick.
Yeah, thanks for being a dick. So it was like a little crowded around our event this year. But I think that was probably the biggest problem, was just the unlicensed vendors fucking pissing me off and that. But fortunately we got no protesters, which is good. And I also found out that our previous I had spread a little bit of a rumor, I realized, in probably last year's post-Pagan Pride episode. So the guy who, Pastor Aiden is the dude's name, the guy who used to protest our event every year, apparently is still alive.
We thought he was dead.
Yeah, we thought he was not dead. The rumor mill said that
he... is he dead?
Yeah, the rumor mill said that he died of COVID. He did not die of COVID. Apparently 7 months ago, he reposted his YouTube video from a couple years ago at our event, and he was like, can't wait to protest this again, and then he never fucking showed up, so... Did you not write down the correct date? Like, we were there, you weren't, so bye-bye. See you next year, maybe. But yeah, it was a really good day overall. We had a big name pagan, Silver Raven Wolf, very popular in the pagan community. She was a great draw for the event. Keep everyone's opinions about Silver Raven Wolf to yourselves. I met her. She is a very lovely woman, and that's what I'm going by. So
a lot of people, I will say this, a lot of people will use her name as an abridging for a type of Wiccan or set of belief that they don't believe in per se. And like Wiccans catch, like, don't get me wrong, some Wiccans are assholes, right? Wiccans as a whole catch a really unfair reputation. Like a lot of people are always like, oh, you fluffy neo-pagan Wiccan, and it's like a string of things that they say together. It's just bullshit. There's far too much in the occult community of like needless superiority and like treating people outside your specific iteration of magic as though they don't have efficacy or like practice, right? And Wiccans get that a shit ton. So I my heart goes out to them because it sucks being stereotyped unfairly.
I agree.
And, you know, like, in my youth and even on this podcast, you know, I may have said things about like my Wiccan phase or whatever, but...
And I've even said, like, Silver Raven Wolf is, like, an abridging to talk about a certain type of mindset, too, right?
But, honestly, like, I don't have any of her books, but I did kind of browse through them and stuff, you know, like, before she was our keynote, and I was reading them, and I was like, alright, there's some solid shit in here. Like, not everything is perfect. No book is perfect, you know, but there's some solid shit in here, and she knows what she's talking about, and just meeting her, she was very fantastic. She was wonderful. Such a welcoming, loving person. It was really cool to interact with her. Unfortunately, Orion Foxwood was not able to show. One of our workshop coordinator was trying to get it coordinated that he would do main ritual, but some things came up and he wasn't able to make it. But he like fell or something, so we hope he's doing better. But yeah. Overall, it was a really successful event. And then for me personally, the highlight of the event was seeing Scott and Darian show up, because we weren't sure with Darian's health issues, like how he'd be feeling, you know, wanting to go out or not. Mm-hmm. But they showed up and Rue fell apart.
I felt so bad for those people that Rue was helping. Rue just like completely just boom, tears fell. And they like, I felt so bad because I was like telling them, I'm like trying to hug Rue and I'm like telling them, like, I'm so sorry. Just give us a moment.
We're having a moment.
Literally 10 minutes before I am to single-handedly call all, I think it was 26 raffles. I remember my count correctly, 24, 26 raffles, and call all these numbers and describe all these products and put on my best show voice. And I really didn't know if they were going to be there. And the fact that they were there obviously was a huge emotional to my soul. And then my mom showed up, and that was a whole nother. I had about 17 mental breakdowns on Pagan Pride Day, but it wouldn't be Pagan Pride Day otherwise. So thank you to Lexa, Vincent, and Todd.
Yes.
And Rick.
Yes. We did have two volunteers show up at the end. I didn't catch their names.
Yeah.
They showed up. They took down some decorations for us, which we appreciate. We appreciate all our volunteers. Yes. Well, I would like some more next year, please.
Please.
Because I'm getting older and creakier. And this year in particular was rough for me because I'm like, my foot is on the tail end, if not already kind of healed sort of thing. But I'm just at the... it's sore and I need to build myself back up to where I was stage
He's
of my
in the
healing.
Physical therapy stage.
Yeah, so basically that's, you know, I've just been using like walking around the mall as physical therapy or like, but Pagan Pride Day was a bitch. It was a bitch of a day. I enjoyed it, but the putting it together part was a bitch. A couple more volunteers would have been wonderful, so please. Please, please, please. You get a free t-shirt and snacks.
Get a free t-shirt and
our love and our love and appreciation.
Love so. And eternal adoration.
Yes. So that's like kind of... Like,
You also get like special time with like presenters and stuff. So like,
yeah,
if we have like
pictures
or whatever that you're like super into, like you actually get like kind of like more one-on-one time.
Mm-hmm. Because they don't know who's who.
I got to sit and eat some barbecue chicken and drink some sparkling grape juice straight out the bottle while singing along to Samhain with my priest Jim Stefanowicz. and that was I always mess up his name. I did it on purpose. But yeah, that was my highlight of the day. That was mwah, love you, Jim.
Oh, that's right. He was singing and you were like chowing down on some
chicken. This is the first thing I eat in all day.
Yeah, I never eat on Pagan Pride Day. I am that terrible sort of neurodivergent, like once I'm hyper fixated on a thing, I cannot eat until the thing is done, and that thing is Pagan Pride Day. And so I have coffee and a donut, and that is about it.
That's about it.
You're an insane man.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know why I do it, but I do it. Thanks, brain. But overall, like that's why we didn't record the past 2 weeks. We were at a furry convention, and then it was Pagan Pride weekend, so we were like very busy back to back. I'm still trying to get my house together. But we did do a lot of fishing, as I would put it, for the podcast. I left a lot of business.
Networking, darling.
I'm calling it fishing.
Fishing is when you try to get somebody's information illegally.
But like fishing in the sense of like, I was thinking like the DKMU, right? Like they cast a net out kind of thing. So maybe I shouldn't use the term fishing. More like crabbing, right?
Yeah, but we're not fishing. We're trawling for oysters.
Right, that's true.
I was just gonna say we're trawling.
Yeah,
we're
trawling. There you
we're
go.
We're trawling.
Anyway, but I was leaving.
Well, a troll and a trawler are slightly different, if I remember correctly.
But to me, I actually, like, I enjoy fishing, and so it feels very much like fishing. Like, when I, like, leave a business card out, and I'm like, here you go, just a little, you'll find
oh,
it.
Oh, yeah.
You'll find it if you need it, kind of thing. And that's honestly how we've been advertising the podcast the entire time it's existed, is, you know, it's just, we tell people about it, either we're spreading the word, or our listeners are spreading the word. I don't pay for advertising. I leave little cookie crumbs in places that I feel like there's a lot of overlap, and at the furry convention there was a ton of overlap, which I love every year, to see all the little witchy, pagan, occulty, queer,
so many Baphomet and devil suits,
yeah,
cute,
yeah,
little fluffy devils everywhere,
yeah. So I'm like, you people are here, you'll like what I, you'll like my shit, here you go. So yeah, I think I gave away probably like maybe 30 business cards, but like I noticed, like, easy. And they were all gone too, like people would be taking them, so I viewed that as a good thing. But yeah, so that's why me and Rue have been in like a black hole for the past like 2 weeks. We've just been busy. Not sure what the rest of you have been up to, if you'd want to share.
I started school again.
Ooh.
The new semester started.
I don't know if you're happy or sad about it. I can't tell.
I mean, like, so I'm happy and sad about it. Like, one of the things is that I'm happy about is that, like, the workload is lighter, oddly enough. I figured that for this course it would be more or equal. It's actually a little bit lighter, which is pleasant. I'm actually, like, kind of able to get homework done much quicker. So that's really nice. Yeah. My professor is not the warmest person. We kind of got off to a weird start, unfortunately, and it's kind of like he started it where I'm trying to like tell him about my accommodations and stuff with the Center of Disability, and I was trying something different where I really hate the fact that, like, when I'm explaining my accommodations to professors, they a lot of the time they expect some type of explanation as to why I have accommodations, and not that I owe, like, them that
you don't
owe anyone anything, but
they're waiting
kind of
for
feel
it.
Like, you know, they're kind of waiting for it. So I tried to do it in a way that made me comfortable, in a way that I thought would be funny, and I was kind of like, just as a heads up, sometimes I get a little weird and I gotta step out of the room for a few minutes. It's all on my, you know, accommodations or whatever. Now, as I'm describing all this stuff, trying to create some kind of rapport, my professor's just like looking down and going, and like packing his bag, and he's not looking at me at all.
Mm-mm.
And I was like, okay. I was like, well, have a good night, professor. And he didn't say nothing, and I just left. I was like, okay. And then the next day, I honestly don't know how I managed it. I left at like 2. I left my house at 2 to get there by 2:40, and it really shouldn't take me that long. But I left at 1:56. I remember I left at 1:56 to get to class by 2:40, which it doesn't take me that long to get from my house to Spring Garden on the subway. But apparently I was like 5 minutes late, which isn't a big deal. And he kind of did this thing. Now, my mom was like, you may have been reading too much into it, which I might have. But he kind of like looked, because my, of course, me being me, Mr. Smooth, my loop, the belt loop on my pants, it caught the door.
Nah.
And I was like, oh, shit. You know, and I had to like back up and like do this thing. And he looked, and I could have sworn my professor rolled his eyes. It looked like he rolled his eyes. I don't know if he did, because I kind of was trying to get my belt loop off of the door.
Right, you're right. He had bigger
problems. And I was,
problems,
like, embarrassed,
sorry,
because,
right?
I'm already, huh? I'm already embarrassed, because, like, I'm in a room full of, like, because everyone in my class, except for one lady, they're all, like, straight out of high school. Like, they all graduated, you know, in, like, just this past
this past summer.
And and I'm like, oh, God. So, like, I'm already kind of, like, we already know these Gen Zs are mean, you know, like, and I'm just like, great. And the one guy, like, stole my seat. And I was like, don't we know how this works? Like, you know, the first day of class, seats are settled by where you land, and that's where you stay the rest of the semester.
That's decorum. That's how it goes.
Right. And I'm like, why did you take my seat, my guy? You know? So that bugged me. So, like, me and my professor aren't vibing the way I wish we were, but the workload's lighter. Tests are more spread out. So kind of hoping that that's kind of hoping I get to just get through this, because I kind of feel like once I'm out of this class, I get to feel kind of like it's like the last stretch, you know,
like the home stretch.
I get to get out of CCP.
Well, that's good.
Yeah. Oh,
very
also,
good.
I also too, I'm actually kind of glad that I have like this like little conglomerate of witches, because I actually wanted to ask y'all a question.
Ooh.
Have any of you ever heard through reading or talking with anyone else of coffee and tobacco being used in baneful work?
In baneful work?
Yeah.
Not really? I've only really heard of coffee and tobacco being used in usually like ancestral veneration.
Right, it's spirit food.
Yeah, like I make a cup of coffee
for the ancestors. My immediate association is Legba. Because like he likes coffee and he likes to smoke and he likes a little candy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's interesting. It's interesting that you say that. Because
Sophia, you make a cup of coffee for Legba every day, for Papa Legba, right?
Oh, that's hush hush, but I guess it's out of the bag now.
I think you've mentioned you've mentioned on the podcast before.
Maybe,
so,
I don't know. I usually try to keep it real quiet. He came to me in a dream once. That's all I'm going to say about it.
Right.
Helped me out of a bad situation, and because of that, I make him a cup of coffee every day.
Yeah, and that's totally fair. Totally fine.
So...
No, we also, I've only heard of it. It makes sense because, it makes sense to me because both of those plants, they developed the cocoa bean or whatever, the coffee bean developed caffeine as a poison, and the tobacco plant developed nicotine as a poison.
Yeah, the tobacco plant straight can kill you.
Yes, to deter things from eating it, both coffee and same thing for chocolate. I can see how it could be used in baneful work because both of those things are technically poisons that somehow humans consume.
Also,
so it is, it's
yeah, mm-hmm. If you wanted to, I could see how you could use it in baneful work, like if you wanted to make someone addicted to something, like make them obsessed with something, you know.
So I want to give I want to give you guys does anybody care if I give you an interesting witch story?
No, please. This is what we do here. This is called content.
So,
no.
I'd be mad if you didn't.
Right? How dare.
So we have new neighbors. My my neighbors moved out and new neighbors moved in. And our neighbors are not very nice people. They're giving all of us the cold shoulder. All of us. My mother, Christian, me and Darian. And I'm talking like it's awkward. Like awkward cold shoulder. Like they'll be sitting on their step and we'll walk up. And they literally, like, you know when someone's like actively trying to not look at you?
Yeah.
And you're just like, hi.
Hi.
And like, well, that started first, right? The awkward, you know.
So they just moved in.
Maybe a month ago, 2 months ago now.
So they're new to the block, and they move in.
They're brand new.
Are they just rude to you, it seems? Have you seen their interactions with other neighbors?
They're quiet to everyone else.
So they're just very, like,
I think it's just because they're literally, like, right next door. Like, their house, their wall is attached to my wall. You know
right,
what I'm
yeah,
saying?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Otherwise, I haven't seen any interactions with anyone else whatsoever.
Okay. So they could be giving everyone the cold shoulder, potentially.
Right. We don't know.
Right.
But, whatchacallit? I only ever see... who I know lives there is a young woman, a young mother, a baby, and two men who are... they look to be brothers Definitely related. They look to be about the same age. Definitely not exactly. They're definitely about our age, that, you know, young, like early 30, mid 30 age range. I suppose it could be like older, mid 20s, maybe. But that's who I see the most. I mostly see them oddly at night, at really like weird times at night. And again, they always ignore me, always. And they ignored everybody. And so weird things started to occur. Just these bouts of like very strange little things that I've ignored. Because I'm just kind of like, I'm over all of it. Like everything. I'm just fucking exhausted. Like,
have you tried
my partner's health? It's starting school. Yeah. If it's not that, it's like, I'm, you know, I have to worry, you know, like my trainer, I'm trying to lose weight. Like it's everything all at once. And I'm just like, okay, I don't care. And then, you know, there's like six planets in Gatorade and all this other stuff. And I didn't really, you know, give a shit. And then all of a sudden, we're bombarded with, moths. I've never had moths in my house ever. I
because like sometimes you get like a moth that gets in the summer and it's flying,
many moths. And I'm like, okay, this is really weird. Now I've lived here for a very long time. Just to clarify, I was here when I was in eighth grade, so I'm 32 now. So what was I saying? All these moths started to appear. So now we have strange neighbors giving cold shoulder. We have run of bad luck, just like really weird happenstances that just wouldn't stop. Just things not working, things breaking, things doing whatever. And then all of a sudden now there's moths everywhere. People are having really strange sleeping patterns. And it's not just me. At first I thought it was just me because I was getting like these really horrible
and sometimes
sort
you're
of liminal
prone to
sleeping.
Insomnia.
Yeah, just like these really, and I mean I'm already a night owl and kind of an insomniac, but this was weird even for me. And other people were starting to report the same thing. And I'm big on you know, once is just a thing, twice is, you know, coincidence, and three times, you know, we're getting into something. And
once is a accident, twice is a trend, and three times is a pattern.
Yeah. Right. And it was pretty much everyone started to report this strange sleeping phenomenon. And I was like, all right, so now we're getting a little weird. Then the moths come and I get this horrible feeling. And it's funny because moths in Appalachian folklore are sort of I suppose you can consider them a portent of death. And obviously all this stuff is more nuanced. Most portents are also omens and they don't always mean something ill, right?
Right.
But the vibe here started to feel sour. So I was like, we're going to do some divination.
That's the exact word I was going to suggest to you and you fucking
said it, right?
yeah.
And I was like, all right, so something's starting to feel sour here. Something's feeling fucked up. So I did some divination. And it was weird because I kept feeling, and I still feel, that something odd, in the sense of like someone's trying to mask something, even while I was reading. I don't know if any of you have ever experienced this. You're trying to read into something and you feel as if something's like stopping you from moving past a certain point,
like there's like a
and you
veil
feel like you're
yeah,
pulling out of it. Yeah. You're trying to pull the reading.
There's a deliberate technique we do in Omnimancy called masking. Yeah, it's like keep
right.
your shit in.
Right. And in folk magic we do that as well. I know the feeling, having been reading since, like, quote unquote, professionally, because I never really know what that means. But since I was 19, so I know the feeling, and I'm like, all right, so this isn't good. because generally it's put there. There's only two ways that gets there. Either you're doing a reading and you don't really want to know the answer to something, right, or someone deliberately put it there. And I was like, I didn't put it, you know, I don't really care about what I get, you know, having been in therapy for so long, I don't mind harsh truths. So I was like, you know, there's nothing I'm hiding from myself. Nothing that I wouldn't say to myself blatantly anyway. So I was like, something odd is happening. Now, we started doing a reading, and at one point I was like, you know what? It's really hard to hide shit from the dead. Even with magic, they're different. And so there are ways to hide things from the dead, but it's, you have to do it intentionally. I started asking the dead questions, and they started to point to next door. And I was like, you know, I said, is it the two men? And they said, yes. I said, are they actively working on us? And then they said, no. And then I was like, oh, that's weird. I said, do they have someone doing it for them? And it said, yes. And it was funny because me, my mom, and Darian all had the same thought, just sort of just internally without saying anything, where when they moved in, I still had my pride, the Progress pride flag up. And I was wondering if maybe that offended them. And I was thinking maybe they're attacking us for that reason. But here's where the story gets really interesting, and almost like it was almost too specific for it to be not true. So started doing more work and started trying to move through some of this cloaking, this obscurification work that they're doing, I started picking up on a desire to flip the house. I think that the two of them want,
they're trying to oust make you guys,
this house uncomfortable.
Yes.
So we leave, and that way they could purchase the house from the people who bought it, as you guys know this story,
your landlord, about my basically house and shit. Yeah.
They want to buy it from them so they could flip the house. And I was like, that's very particular. You know
that's
what I mean?
Predatory.
That's a very specific way to read. You know what I'm saying?
That is just so predatory. Like to move next to someone and then look at their house and be like, I want to chase you out of there so I can take your fucking house, flip and sell it. That is fucked up.
Right.
I'm gonna start throwing bricks. All right, let's go.
And now last night, Darian was over at a friend's house playing Switch, and I was bored out of my friggin' skull, and I was like, I'm gonna go for a walk. So I get all my shit together, I get a sweat towel because like I sweat profusely, and
I
go outside, and I'm closing the door behind me, and who's coming up the street but these two men. Now, I see them. I know that they don't fucking talk to me, so I'm not going to talk to you anymore, right?
Right.
Like, I ain't saying
you're
shit
like,
to you, because I already think you're fucking trying to work on me.
It's been a month, bro.
So I ignore the shit out of them, and I get, like, it's funny, because as I'm walking away and they're behind me, I get, like, this, like, I know they're looking at me. Like, you know that feeling when you're being watched? And I was like, ugh, creepy. I was like, just keep walking. So I do my walk, I finish my walk, I get home, I get to my door. Now, here's the thing. I don't think that they did it. I don't think that they did this last night. I think I just didn't recognize it when I was leaving. But I get to my door, and there is a very distinct smell in my doorway, and it smells like coffee and tobacco. And I ignore it because I was like, it's probably just a musty door. My door is old. It's made of wood. Whatever. Now, here's where it gets weird, I guess. It's already weird. But anyway. Right. Darian comes home from his friend's house, and he opens the vestibule door, and he goes, babe? And I go, yeah. He goes, please come here. And I go, okay. And he goes, why did you splash tobacco and coffee on the door? And I go, and it's funny because I smile for a second, and I kind of try to chase it away because I want him to be impartial. You know what I mean? I wanted to see.
Yeah.
Because if Darian is really good at anything, like I always say, because Darian has what is his particular clear smelling when he
clair
aliens,
I have that
so,
too.
Yeah, he's like my psychic bloodhound. And I was just like, you know, I tried to like get rid of it because I wanted him to be as impartial as possible. And I was like, what are you talking about? And he goes, look, there's a splash mark that I couldn't see because it was dark last night. But he had turned on, he had smelled it and had the instinct to turn on the vestibule light, the hallway light in between, you know, the vestibule. And there's a splash mark, like something, like it, and then the water ran down. And I was like, oh, and I smelled it and it smells exactly like tobacco and coffee. And he goes, well, and he asked me, he goes, well, that seems very folk magic like. So he's like, that's your thing. And I was like, the problem with that, I said, is that in any of my traditions, that those products are particularly used for cleansing, protection, but also strongly spirit food. We use those to feed the spirit.
Did you see any grains of tobacco left behind?
No. No, I did not.
And it's potential that they use tobacco bitters, which is a type of alcohol that smells like tobacco and is derivative of it. That potentially could have been it.
And the only thing that I see, it's the only thing that I could think of was that there that it was a sign of like, because the only, like, no one would, you could, I mean, I don't want to make a sweeping generalization because obviously you can use a wash, right? But it, they definitely weren't like washing in the way to
yeah, they cleanse. Just like chucked it at the door.
Right. It was meant to some type of attack.
Maleficarum.
Yeah,
it was some type of maleficarum, beneficum, right. And it was odd to use those particular products to me, but then I was wondering if this is something I've heard in the past where you can sort of use offerings if you desecrate your own offerings to, and you throw that, it's kind of like in Japan they do this you have to gift the curse and you sort of desecrate the offering on someone else's property to piss off the spirits that you work with. And that came to mind. Maybe they were, that was something that they give their spirits. They are, you know, and the thing is like their traditions would be a bit more foreign to me because they're Latino of some kind.
Okay. So that was going to be like, my next question. I was like, you know, like what ethnicity are they?
I don't like to racialize my stories because I always feel like it gets really weird.
No. But, yeah. I totally get that. But at least in this case, you can maybe figure out like culturally, like how you could trace it back to, you know, where those associations came from.
But, so yeah. So like so I don't really know. I don't really know what the hell. I mean, well, I think I know what's going on as far as divination is concerned, but that part was really weird to find
coffee and tobacco.
That. Because Darian's the one that spotted it. Well, he smelled it and he was like, this is weird. And he's the one that was like, let me turn the light on.
What I'm getting out of this is that your version of my hips don't lie is the dead don't lie.
It's true. The dead don't lie.
You know, the dead don't lie, and I'm starting to feel all right.
They definitely don't lie to me, that's for sure. So I don't know. It's very strange. It's a very strange situation to be in because there's also more to this. I'm so sorry to take all this time on it.
No.
Please.
So I was just having a conversation with Martine. Pagan Pride Day. And I ended up buying some Forthies vinegar to wash my step and everything with.
There you go.
And she also ended up giving me like a nail. A nail that she had consecrated engraved dirt for forever. And it's funny because I put the nail above the doorway. And when I did that, mysteriously, all the moths are gone.
Interesting.
Oh, speaking of moths appearing and disappearing, I forgot about this little bit too. There was another night where I was leaving my house. I was going to the gym, and this is only like a week ago. I was going to the gym, and a very large moth. Now, I had stepped down, and something flew out from beneath my feet, and it startled the hell out of me because I live in Philly, so I thought it was a flying roach. And
right.
So I was like, no! And of course, you know, my gay ass is like screaming.
You're like,
and what you call it? It was a giant moth, and this moth flew around me and then landed on their house, like right there. And I was like, well, if this isn't like something. So that was another thing that happened before last night with the coffee and the tobacco.
It definitely sounds like someone or some, you know, definitely someone in that house is working on you. Whether they're doing it themselves or getting someone else to do it on their behalf. I mean, that's what it sounds like to me. You know, all signs kind of point to that. I'm sure you know what you're doing in response, you know, how you're going to handle your response.
I mean, like, it's funny because me and Darren keep saying the same thing. It's like they're trying really hard to do a thing
that they're not going to be able to do.
It's so weird. The sense of it, like, see, this is why I love being able to read magic, like psychically read magic, because it really helps you determine what's happening, like, with it. And it's easier to unravel it when you can feel it and read it. It doesn't feel like it's sticking the way they want to.
No. Yeah, that's kind of...
Right? See, it's so funny that you got that sense. You're not the only one.
Yeah, and also, like, I get the sense from you, too, in the way that you're talking about it. Because if you felt that, like, it was sticking more, you would be a lot different in the way you'd be telling the story.
I would be more concerned. I'm not, like... The thing is, the only thing that we know also through reading is that I do have to... So the reading also said that I have to actively work against it because however they're fueling it, it's they were clever enough to make sure to use items and things to that self-perpetuate the spell, which there are ways to do that, especially when you use like clever binding agents, the way you bind your spell at the end. If you know what you're doing, it's pretty easy to have a self-perpetuating spell. So it's going to keep working as long as I don't actively get rid of it. So I actually have pretty much everything I need to get rid of it.
It's one of those things. It's like if you ignore it, it will get bigger and spicier and harder to handle. And
yeah, because
kind of
it's
going to
look... Right, it's going to look for an opportunity. Like once my defenses go down, and I'm not like, you know. But the thing is like I've been really keeping up with my ancestral work lately.
Good.
Like a lot, like regularly, and like everyone just feels a lot better. Just having, because I like set up this beautiful little ancestral altar downstairs in the living room, and everyone just really likes having it there. It's really peaceful, and you know, so I really think that because this is an ancestral home for me,
right?
That I think that this is kind of their territory, and you're not gonna fuck with their house. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah. It's their house more than anything. You know?
Right. So like, I think that a lot of that is also kind of holding up this, you know.
Well, yeah,
first line of defense.
You have kind of like an army of the dead behind you, in a way. You know what I mean?
Pretty
like you
much.
Have a battalion that's just like, oh, you want to? You know, get out of here. So
right.
I mean,
so
you
I
have a really solid, yeah.
But it's funny because they saw me one time just to do something to mitigate some of it. The two men, they were walking up this one time. Again, I always catch them walking up the damn street
right
at night, always two of them, both of them at the same time. They like go nowhere without each other. And
interesting.
I was scattering angelica root on the steps because Darian keeps telling me, and we haven't done it yet, I might do it today, although it's been raining, but I'll see. He goes, we need to check under the mats. We have the doormats outside. He's like, I want to check under the doormats. And we haven't really done it yet. And it's mostly because I started school. And it's kind of like, unfortunately, like, you know, living in this economy. Mm. And trying to be a witch is really hard.
Yes.
Yes.
So I'll probably do that today because I keep like the four thieves vinegar is like staring at me right in the face right now, and I'm like, I probably should do it. The only thing is like every time I try to do magic on the doorstep, they're like, I swear they're like, they're there. I'm just like, you asshole, stop seeing me do stuff.
And it's weird because you keep seeing them at night, so it's not like you can come out like in the cover of darkness or anything like that because they're out there at night.
I'm at a point now though where like I really should probably just get over that because it's not like I haven't done weird shit, and like I've had like the whole street backed up with traffic like because like a Phillies game, and I'm outside like with herbs like cleansing the front of the house. People are just staring at me and I'm just like, yeah, yeah, you know. I don't care.
Yeah, we've had instances like that too. Like when we were using the spirit spike, we'd be using it inside, but then we had to go outside and drive it into the ground. So I'm just going outside onto my front lawn and just shoving this giant nail into the dirt. And I'm pretty sure there was a neighbor out there, and I was like, just ignored them.
All of our neighbors, I'm pretty sure, have heard the chanting from the multiple rituals that we have held in our house because we live in a row home in Northeast Philly.
Yeah, that's very true.
And I think at this point they're like, it's pretty normal.
Yeah, like has to. I mean, you know,
I'm very content
like,
with being the weird neighbor. I'm okay with it.
Very.
I'm perfectly fine with it.
Yeah.
I'll never forget. I was doing weather magic with my broom, and my one neighbor from like, and I'm talking like he's like he was houses down, and I didn't see him out there. He startled the shit out of me. He goes, "What are you doing?" And I'm like trying to like sweep the sky with my broom, trying to get rid of the rain.
Like there's
what
a bee.
What are you doing?
There's a bee. Fucking bee.
And
fire.
I was like, "Oh, nothing."
Nothing.
Because, again, I'm not smooth. And yeah, that was fun, but I don't care. I really don't care.
It would just be really fun if you just launched into it. Well, I'm sweeping the sky because I'm doing weather magic and blah, 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 blah. And you'd be like, I need
I
to
actually
call.
Figured
I
that
like
that's
the
something
I
would...
unabashed like that. Like,
I figured
honestly.
That's how you usually are, right, Sophia? Like when people like if you were outside doing that or something like you would just
mm-hmm.
be like, here's the
mm-hmm.
facts.
Mm-hmm.
Take of it 1000%. What you will. Usually I find some middle ground sort of answer. Like, what was it? It was right before Pagan Pride, I was buying some decorations. I'd stopped in a Dollar Tree, and I was buying some decorations. And the cashier, I was listening to her conversation with the person ahead of me. And the cashier, you know, she was like, oh, you know, something on Sunday, I'll be cleaning my house and... you know, get over to church. And I'm like, wow, if you're cleaning your house and going to church, like you're pretty, you know, dedicated Christian, you know, going to church, whatnot. And so when I'm pulling up with all this like spooky Halloween fall harvest decoration stuff for a pagan event, she's like, oh, you decorating your house? And I'm like, yeah, you know, it's just time to decorate, me and the wife. You know, I had to like default to that because I was like, I cannot be like, yeah, I'm having a pagan fucking harvest festival fundraiser. Like I could have, but that would have made my life probably a little more difficult in the dollar store. And so I was like, yeah, you know, we're just decorating the house.
Oh, wretch though, when you see the look on their face.
Right.
I think it also makes it like even harder because like, of course, we're all queer. So it's like, you know,
right.
The queer, like, you know, heretic witch vibes, you know, and you're just like,
Yes.
I mean, that's extra points, you know.
For us, yes.
I always find it really funny when I have to like play the normie game, right? Like I think of it as like a game. Like I'm like, ooh, what's the thing that will make your brain the most happy with me? Okay, so what response can I give you that will placate your worldview? Go.
Right. so much. It's so funny that you say that because I was just I followed this like Appalachian ghost and spirits kind of thing group. I was just curious, And it's so funny because, like, the few times that I've commented, like, I have to be, like, very, I don't know, broad about the things that I say. And I kind of feel like I have to, like, dumb myself down a little bit. Because, like, conversations have, like, almost steered into, like, for instance, like, necromancy places. And, like, necromancy is just one of those things that you don't talk to normies about. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
They don't like the word. They don't want to hear about it.
They're dead. We don't want to talk about it.
You were saying how you were, when you were talking about summoning the dead or talking to the dead, I was literally going to say this, but I didn't want to interrupt you. Plus, I was taking a hit. I was going to say, oh, yeah, Scott doing classic necromancy. That's what's up.
It's true, though. That's
like my jam. Folk necromancy is my thing. But yeah, like, I can't talk to people about that. Like, that's why it's not like I could just tell these people, I'm like, oh yeah, if you want to go talk to your family members, just get a human femur or a animal femur and drum their grave.
And they'll be like,
while calling their name, they'll call them right up. You know, like, I can't be doing this stuff.
Like necromancy, and they cannot lie. You other witches can't deny.
Scott,
oh,
you
God.
Should
did you guys hear about the
really
the
do
corpse
a workshop
water debacle?
No, corpse water.
What corpse water debacle?
Enlighten us.
So, young TikTok practitioners found the concept where they found corpse water.
Okay.
Due to some plagiarized TikTok spellbook grimoire that got published.
Wonderful.
And it caused, like, apparently I was off TikTok for a while.
You're on sabbatical.
I only recently came back to it. And apparently it caused, like, a 2-3 month
war,
like, heated debate, like, flame war, where everyone was just like, who in their right mind would do such a thing? That's so disrespectful. And then you have people who were like, it's appropriation. And then you had people say, what else did they say? I've been practicing for 5 years and I've never heard of it. And I was like, oh God.
Five millennia.
I don't want to make people feel like they're not good at their practice, but,
sit down and shut up.
Practicing for 5 years is not the flex you think it is.
No, it is not.
That's all I have to say.
And, like, and I'm not saying that they're not capable of doing magic. That's also just as for our readers, our listeners. I'm sure that someone who's been practicing for 5 years is more than capable of performing magic. But just because something in magic you haven't heard of at the point of 5 years in your practice does not mean that it's new, doesn't mean that it's appropriative, doesn't mean anything.
Let me clarify what I mean.
You're not a master.
Five years is not the flex you think it is. I mean, you could be excellent, right? Mm-hmm. But the hard truth is most people who've been doing magic have been doing it for a copiously long amount of time. The reason I say it's not the flex that you think it is because your magical aptitude is more of a flex than stating an arbitrary number, right? If you've been studying for 5 years and you can display heavy amounts of knowledge and conversation, or you have a deeply intricate personal practice, that goes a lot further than, say, somebody who's had 10 years of fucking around and doing jack diddly shit and reading a couple of books here and there.
Agreed.
Right? But at the same time, 5 years is not a flex when a lot of people who've been doing this have been doing it since they were like 12 or like 8 or whatever the fuck, right? Like a lot of people have been doing magic most of their lives. So don't, if you're going to try and bring something to the table and state how practiced at magic you are, talk about your practice. Don't say like I've got 5 years, because you're going to get shut down hard in conversations with that. People are going to be like, cool, I've been doing this for 30 years.
Right.
And the thing is you can tell a serious practitioner of magic too, because they'll be like, listen, I've been doing this for 30 years and I still learn shit. I still figure shit out. Like, I didn't know that. So, I mean, that's how you know you found a good one.
Like, we know everything.
No.
Right.
And we've been doing this long fucking time.
No, I will say, in the grade school, they kind of... So, Oberon Zell was the one who founded the school. And his official title... So, he was headmaster of the school. Now, it's this guy Kingsley, Headmaster Kingsley. He runs it, since Oberon is considerably older. So, Oberon is Adeptus. That's the title that they give him within the school. And so it was kind of interesting, like, in one of the beginning classes, they're talking about, like, the different levels of sort of wizardry that they put. You know, you have your apprenticeship, and then your journeyman, and then, you know, you have, like, master, and then they actually said, they were saying there is kind of a level after master called Adeptus, which they kind of put it as, like, kind of like you become comfortable with the amount of knowledge and everything that you have attained at that point in your lifetime, you know? And it's just kind of like, it's not that you're ignoring anything new, it's not that you're trying to debunk anything, but it's just that you have reached a level of such comfort in your style of magic and what you know about magic that you feel like... It's not that you stop learning, it's just you just reached like a point where you're like, I feel that I have a good grasp on everything that I would need to teach to someone else.
I get that. Mm-hmm. I mean, not that obviously I'm not anywhere near that, but what mm-hmm. I mean is, like, I understand it in the sense of, like, I remember, it's kind of what made me a little bit more, it's reminiscent for me of when I was younger. I was a bit more syncretic, a bit more eclectic, and then I kind of was like, but certain systems aren't working the way other systems do for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, so how about we just only focus on the things that I make work really well, you know? So, like, that's why, you know, I tend to focus on the way I do, because that's the magic that really works for me. The systems of magic that really work for me.
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of reminded me of that. It like it's almost like the freshman, you know, like it's like it had levels, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I feel like that level is at an age where I'm not even close to, but you get what I'm getting at. There's a certain realization, you know what I'm saying?
A realization when you're like, oh, I have figured out the style of magic that perfectly adapts to, you know, kind of how I need to interact with the world. So, yeah, I always thought that was kind of interesting. I think sometimes I live too far in the future and I think about what old wizard me is gonna look like and be like, and, you know, I hope I'm not too cranky and crotchety. I don't think I will be, but
I really hopefully hope not. That I'm not. I really just, my goal is to be like that mysterious but very kindly old hag that, like, you know, lives in the woods on, like, a small little homestead.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I bake and I make tea.
And everyone loves me and fears me simultaneously.
Exactly! That's literally exactly
you
it.
You love me and you fear me.
I want that, what should I call it? The family legacy. That's how they treated in my great-great-grandmother. Tell everyone treated her in the holler in the old Appalachian hills and stuff. According to the family legends, she was sort of loved and feared simultaneously.
That's fair. And let's think that's kind of it's the goal,
right? I was like, I want that for myself.
It's every witch's dream. But we are just a little bit over an hour. Sophia, is there anything that you kind of wanted to catch us up on? What you've been doing, or? You just been chilling?
I mean, no.
No, that's okay. That's fair. That's fine.
No.
All good.
All good.
I have not. No, it's not no that I don't want to catch you up. Oh, okay. No, I have not been just chilling.
Oh, okay. Okay.
I've been doing stuff.
Anything of note?
Well, a guy harassed me last night in a way that was very impending and threatening. Probably going to have to start carrying a knife on me again. You know, that's life in Toronto right now.
So things are getting
but
heated there?
I wouldn't even say things are getting. It's just that anytime that you're a pretty girl and you're heading home by yourself and you're outside on the street waiting for a bus, you have a risk. And the thing that people in the TTC don't necessarily understand is that when they modify bus routes and make it so that you can't wait inside a bus station for your bus, that puts you more at risk to be harassed, which is exactly what happened. Like, a guy got up in my face and fucking screamed at me.
Yeah.
It was not a good experience. I'm just going to carry a knife on me from now on, so if somebody fucks with me, they will get the knife.
Yeah.
And the hard truth is, I would rather go to jail for carrying a knife or assault with a deadly weapon than I would be made into a victim by some would-be bastard. You know what I mean?
That is absolutely valid and fair.
Yep.
I've had
that was last night. That was literally last night. I'm fine though. I got my magic. I got my bullshit.
Feel that.
My street knowledge. But yeah, it was not a good time. So people suck. Stop harassing women on the street. Just because a pretty girl exists doesn't mean she owes you anything, like fucking anything, like anything at all. Just leave her the fuck alone.
Not the time
just
of
like
day.
She exists. Nothing. She's allowed to move from point A to point B without you fucking harassing her. Like, dressing nicely is not an invitation to harassment. Fucking hate
it. Not a sign of interest either.
No.
A woman being nice to you is not a sign of interest. It's just a sign of.
I wasn't even being nice. I was staring at the fucking concrete, looking away from the guy with my headphones on, not listening to him or acknowledging him.
So,
like,
you know. Goes.
Every sign was there. He should have fucking known. He just chose to be a shithead, is what he did. Mm-hmm. So, fuck him.
And
fuck anyone who knows him.
Well, it makes me feel better knowing that you, Sophia, are very, particularly capable of self-defense. And I know that about you, which makes me feel very good.
Yeah, I felt pretty threatened last night, though, not gonna lie, because it wasn't just him, there was like two other guys.
Oh, okay.
That's when it's a problem.
That's when you're like, I don't know about that.
Yep.
I can handle one guy, especially that guy, like a cakewalk, if it's 1v1. If it's 3v1, any bets off.
Yeah, I hear that. Like, not everyone thinks, you know, not everyone is John Wick on the inside.
I mean, don't get me wrong, I'm a good fighter.
Right.
I'm a good fighter, but I'm out of shape for it, and I don't know what they're capable of. Like, that's a hard truth about anybody who does enough of this stuff, is you know that even sizing up an opponent, he could look like nothing and be like the most fucking hardcore bastard, right? Like, you don't necessarily know. You can take a look at his body and make a rough assessment, but when the rubber hits the road, it's a little fucking different, you know?
Hmm.
I was just telling my trainer about how a large reason why I'm going on this journey is so that way I can learn self-defense, that I can be in better shape to defend myself.
For
real, for real. Queers, stay sharp, stay fit, because they're coming. And like, another thing is, I don't want to fear monger, right? But also, like, one of my partners, I have two now. When one of my partners was taking me out for my birthday for like a dinner, we were holding hands and we walked by a old guy and he pulled out his phone and started playing Try That in a Small Town. And I said to him, I'm like, is that Try That in a Small Town? And I said, you fucking coward, I am from a small town. And he kept walking and he pursed his lips in bitter resentment because he's like an old fucking white cis hetero angry guy who, like, I guess his parents never loved him was his deal.
Yeah. Wow. The other day we were picking up Salad Works and we drove by the Trump store and I spit in front of their store and I flipped him off. That was kind of fun up in Ben Salem.
Oh, yeah.
Yay!
I was like,
fuck
yeah.
There is a book in Barnes and Noble's written by that grease stain of a fucking shit stain. And it's literally letters from famous people supposedly written to DGT. And it's just, he put this book together and it was produced in America. And somehow he has a book in Barnes and Noble's while he's supposed to be in jail.
It was on a fucking end cap.
It was on an end cap.
It was called Letters to And I was like, and it's pictures of a bunch of letters. And I opened the book. I was like, all right, I like self-harm. So I opened the book, right? The first page I open up to is fucking Richard Nixon. That's the first fucking page I open up. It's a page.
That's a little,
on the nose.
Does he not know that's a little too self-aware and on the nose?
So I open up to, so it's on the right page. It's fucking Richard Nixon's fucking face. And then on the left page, it's a letter. It's a picture of a letter that apparently Richard Nixon wrote to Trump. All of these letters, by the way, look photoshopped to shit. Just saying. But anyway, so then I look that there's writing underneath where it says Richard Nixon and it has Nixon's face, and then it says Richard Nixon was a very smart guy, and I was like, oh my fucking god! Like, I was just. I was like, oh no, we gotta go. We gotta leave the store.
The shit was published and put on an end cap.
Yeah.
You see, Trump is a very smart, logical man, a real leader man. Some might say he never leadered like him before. Nobody leadered like Trump did ever. That man leadered more than a leader.
Thanks, Obama. Oh.
Thanks, Obama.
If I can also...
Thanks, Obama, for your double taps. You know, the policy where you'd shoot a drone strike in an area, wait for help to arrive, like paramedics and children and women, and then bomb the area again for maximum casualties on the civilian classification. Just real classic Obama move right there, along with Medicare for All, was it?
Yeah, which worked-ish. Yeah. It worked-ish.
Also gave gays the right to marry. It's just like that.
Yeah, that
I'm
did
not a
happen
centrist. I'm a very far leftist.
You did that.
People may not understand my political classifications until I lay out like that, because they're like, She's hating on the lefties. She's us, right? I'm like, no, you're even worse.
I hate them all.
You're all bad.
But if I also, there was just a point that Sophia made earlier when Sophia, you said not to fearmonger, but I honestly think that making sure that we do remind queer people to learn self-defense,
mm-hmm.
Get, you know, if that looks, whether it's martial arts or boxing, which boxing is martial arts, or learning how to shoot, getting, you know, your license to carry.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever it is. Right now, and I don't think it's fear-mongering for us to say this. I think it's just learn self-defense. I know.
Yeah, I mean, like, I had two instances of hate crimes in the past fucking, like, 3 weeks-ish. Like, it's fucking happening. Careful.
An old family friend of mine, about 2 weeks ago, her stepbrother, coincidentally she's also part of the legitimate croix herself, but her stepbrother is gay. And he was at a popular after hours nightclub here called Voyeur, and in Philly, you know, everyone always likes to be like, Philly's the stronghold, you know. The thing is that's a lot more nuanced than what people think. And unfortunately,
it is, yeah.
These two gentlemen, use that term loosely, walked up to him and were like, hey, can we get a lighter? And when he went to pull a lighter out, they sucker punched him. And then called him the F slur and ran away. So, yeah, learning how to defend yourself, no matter where you are, no matter, even if you think your city is like super progressive or whatever, just, it's not about that. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's about people are so angry and they hate othered people so much that they just want to hurt you. So it doesn't matter if you think your city's safe, it doesn't really, that's not, it's irrelevant to needing to defend ourselves.
Those fringe against. People, like,
they're... I can also lay out exactly why it's happened so much right now, too.
I mean, there's been beyond a huge just Trump platform.
Right now. Yes, but beyond just Trump right now, old white guys realizing the world is changing.
And they're dying.
It's changing
out.
In ways they don't like. Exactly. Mm-hmm. It's changing in ways not only do they not like, but it's also changing without them. And yeah. It's not just strangers. It's not just like people at a distance. It's their own grandkids. Mm-hmm. It's their own family members who continue to move on the times with, like, who've continued to move on with the times. They're resentful because the specific ideology they've bought into has distanced themselves from anybody who ever cared about them because they've let hatred wrap its way around their hearts and literal white supremacy. But the thing with white supremacy is it's insidious. It starts off looking like it's a little thing at first, and you never really realize how far it goes, right? Yep. It's little things like expecting other people to just automatically know white cultural references or like adhere to white academic interpretations of how the world works and delegitimize indigenous and non-white worldviews in the process, right? Mm-hmm. There's a lot of things that are intrinsic to it that a lot of people, even very well-intentioned people, participate in. And that's just something to be aware of. It's not something to deride anybody, right? Mm-hmm. But these guys go whole hog with the most worst aspects that you could of that sort of thing. So they're isolated, they're mad, and they're angry. And people are giving them an outlet and other people to blame, right? So you're getting this wild form of hatred happening because it's the dying breath of old men who failed to hold on to the world indefinitely, like for some reason they thought they were going to be able to, right?
Yeah.
Because like they really truly thought that they were going to be able to keep the world the way they wanted it for forever. That's why they never passed power on, right? Mm-hmm. That's why they did everything in their power to keep the world as regressive and backwards as possible, because they wanted it to stay exactly as it was, in their benefit and nobody else's. And now that they can't have that, they are petulant, they are furious, and they don't have any outlet but hatred at people who are different than them. And that's the long and the short of the whole fucking situation, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I would definitely agree.
I'll get off my soapbox now.
Nah, I would definitely agree. Like, it is, it's the dying breath of that old generation. But the thing that also does kind of freak me out too is I'm also not happy with the young tech bro generation either. You know what I mean? I'm not really thrilled about them and everything that.
Here's the thing: we always see the loudest and most garish parts of society online. Yeah. If you take online discourse as any barometer, you'd think the majority of the world is conservative and is out there to get you. But those it's are not. Typically the people who are socially isolated from other people and don't have anything better to be doing with their time than to be spreading hate and vitriol online.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
So like, it's the same thing with like the tech bros who are absolute fucking simping for like Elon Musk. Those mm-hmm. people are doing that because their views have ostracized them from anybody who has any degree of awareness or empathy, which is also why those people have such a predisposition towards like the alt-right pipeline. It's mm-hmm. because they don't have any other outlets for people who agree with their radical and toxic viewpoints or who are willing to stomach their negative behavior. So they naturally funnel into the only spaces that'll tolerate them, which leads to more bad behavior, right? Mm-hmm. It's a fucking downward death spiral, and it sucks because the majority of people would want to de-radicalize these people, but at the same time, they're very adventurously against de-radicalization. And it's also not everybody's job to de-radicalize fuckers, because like honestly, the people who end up having to do the work are the most vulnerable and affected populations,
yep.
who are the most at risk if anything goes wrong with that person, right?
Mm-hmm.
So very often, as I preach about on this podcast, the people who actually have the power to make a difference very seldomly actually do something, and the people who have social, negative social clout, if you will, like any type of disadvantage or minority status, it's always them who have to fight for themselves, because mm-hmm. other people are just not willing enough to
not at all
help them or to provide them the chances that they need to move forward appropriately, right? And it fucking sucks.
Yeah.
It's actually funny, so, Jay, that you mentioned that particular group of people, because I was just watching a very educated guy. He was, you know, I mean, honestly, he said the same thing as Sophia, really. He was just mentioning the fact that a lot of the large portion of that group you mentioned, that's sort of like that tech, you know.
Tech bros.
A lot of them, what's not noticed is that a lot of them are very young.
Yeah.
A lot of them are from like the ages of like 12 to, you know, maybe 20. I personally still see 20 as a teenager, but that's just from personal experience. But a lot of them are looking for, it's funny because I almost feel like they've, you know, people like Andrew Tate and Musk, they've kind of went for that group because they knew that they're a group that, you know, on a biological level, they're looking for identity. And right. when you're that young, that's for all of us, no matter who you are. We just biologically are searching for identity in our teens. And when you're given something that you can rally behind, especially at that age, mm-hmm. when you can't think critically, and you can only really ever see you can't ever see really too far outside of yourself. You are your whole world at that age.
Yeah.
And whether it was intentional or not, I don't know. I don't want to be, although it feels that way. Mm. You know, I think that he agreed though with Sophia that this guy, he said that they're almost inconsequential. Mm. And even though they are concerning, it is, but he says that essentially what he was getting at was that the vast majority of them will change by the time they're older. And those that don't will still be a minority amongst right. the population. A lot of them are right now just looking for something to, a place to belong. And inside of that gamer tech, you know, that whole, what is that? Stupid guys that do that, pickup artists. You know, that whole thing, because right. that's all that community. They all kind of encompass that.
Yeah.
And so inside of all of that is just a large portion of young people, young men, cis men particularly, looking for identity. And a lot of them will age out of it. And those
I'm
that
hoping
don't
so.
Will be,
like, know. That's what I'm really hoping so. Because a lot of these tech bros, like, they just have this, you know, make money, make this, you know, have reputation, make money, fuck all the people and resources you need to, you know, like, it doesn't matter, everything is unlimited, you can do whatever you want, and,
right, I'm a high value man,
right, and and I'm have self-worth, care, you know, start a business, whatever, but
all that's great, yeah,
be
totally.
Ethical, you know, so like I'm hoping right. that they grow out of this like consume
and
kind
not
of,
all of them
mentality
will, you know, not yeah. all of them will. I mean, you know, one thing that I know that we've discussed before, and I know that we have, whereas like we talk a lot about like how one day in the future these horrible conservative ideas will eventually die out. But that process isn't going to be tomorrow.
No,
it's not going to be 2 years from now.
Multi-generational.
You know, right. It's gonna take time.
Yeah.
You know. So like, I guess. in a lot of ways, I was concerned about them too until I actually was listening to this man. And obviously he was much more educated than myself, but he was very intelligent and very practical about it. And he was like, it is concerning, but here's the details. Here's the projections. Here's what we feel we know, you know, from That's an educated comforting. Perspective.
That's definitely
so
comforting.
It definitely wasn't as, it's grim, but not as grim as I think we feel it is.
Yeah.
Because as Sophia said, they really still are the minority. You know, the vast majority of us don't want what's happening.
No.
You know, just like how the vast majority of us are, you know, what was it I was reading? Like, I was watching something and like these conservative politicians are like, they were all like, how could so many Americans be like, not pro-war? You know, they were so astonished that we were like, we want the least amount of wars possible.
Yeah, no wars,
and
please.
They're like, how, it's un-American. I'm like, oh god.
The reason they say that is because they want to set the overtone window that Americans are war hungry and thirsty for blood, because it suits the narrative that they can then use to have more wars and pay Lockheed Martin more to maintain military superiority. Not that y'all are ever going to give up military superiority anytime soon.
No, that'll also unfortunately take time, you know, but it was funny because I don't want to keep this going because we've been going for a while, but because this conversation can go into a whole bunch of things. Like, I was also just talking, me and Darren were talking about how if we could funnel all the money that we put into our military, if we could funnel that back into education and the arts, how much better America would just be overall.
Yeah.
If we could just take, you know, like, you know, I don't know, all of those billions, trillions of dollars funneling into our military force.
No, we must bomb the little brown children. Come on now, you know
That's
how it
America's
is.
America's way. Terrible.
And then we blame it on
think
or we
that you have
to
a right
home,
to change the
you know,
world.
Virtuous.
Well, we feel like we're the world's police, you know.
I know.
Team America, world police.
Fuck yeah.
I suggest everyone watch that. Watch Team America. Exactly. Watch Team America if you haven't yet, because it's probably the best
it's
commentary on American culture.
Racist,
it is.
Oh, yeah.
It is.
Terrible.
Well, I mean, it's made by the guys who do South Park, so if that's not your jam, you won't like it. But if
Trey
you can...
Parker and Matt Stone are kind of bastards.
Yeah, their humor is fucked up. But I think, I don't know. This is kind of how I feel like about like adult cartoons like that, is like no one is safe on them. So like they do make fun of literally everybody. So
yeah,
even on The Simpsons too, no one's safe there either. So I don't know. It's one of those things. If that's your humor, but yeah, Team America, World Police, we're terrible. But we have been yammering on for almost an hour and a half now, probably because we didn't have anything the last 2 weeks, because we've, like I said earlier, me and Rue were caught in a black hole in the time-space continuum of too many things to do. But we are going to wrap things up here. I did want to give a shout-out to Mike Stewart from...
Mike Stewart...
Or Stewie, I think is usually what he goes. Anyway, he subscribed to us on fucking Buzzsprout, like, just before we started recording. He is subscribing, he has given us $5 a month, and we appreciate every five of
Thank
those
you.
Dollars.
What was his name again? What was his name?
Mike Stewart,
you motherfucker. We didn't think it was gonna happen, but it did finally. You're the first person to subscribe who isn't personally affiliated with us in some form or another through a relationship or friendship or
they are.
Otherwise.
They are.
So yeah.
They
are. Oh, I think
they're a friend, but still,
they are friend.
Good
I
job.
Think. Oh, yeah, they are. Yeah, in a way, yeah.
They have been
of.
Part of. Mike is part. Mike.
Pig and Pride and stuff.
PewDiePie.
Her glove.
Yeah,
tradition.
They are part of the. Okay, take all the words out of my mouth. All right. I'll
oh, sorry. I just was listing things.
No, I was just, you know, I've been the one that's been texting Mike for the past 3 days. Yes, Mike, wonderful Mike. Thank you so much. Appreciate you. Love you. Seriously mean it.
They are a wonderful part of our community, and Pagan Pride and Distelfink and Erglava wouldn't be the same without you. So appreciate you, love you, thank you.
Yes, that's all. Appreciate
and anybody else who subscribes to the show, you too can have us blather on about how much we appreciate you when you subscribe.
Yes, we
will. You don't have to.
We'll dedicate an entire episode in your honor. Just
I heard JK. Defecate an entire episode in your honor, and I was like, whoa, there, bud.
Okay,
that's going very specific route.
We are not doing that. Redacted. So
redacted.
Alrighty. I think we're going to wrap things
up. There, bud.
We're going to wrap things up here for today. I believe we will be back next week. I don't think, because next week is,
will
I know
we,
build day is Saturday
really
and Saturday. Sunday. So yeah, we should
be
able to record next week. Yeah, so if you haven't, or if this is your first time listening to us, we do have a Discord community. All of the links to all of our various social media presences and online communities. Really the only one worth going into is Discord. It's the only one we really update and like have any kind of activity on. Honestly, there is a Facebook group, but like I hate Facebook with an extreme passion. So yeah.
And social media.
I really hate social media. I only post to it to feed the algorithm so people can find the podcast, and that's really about it. So if you want to interact with us and like really chill with us, join the Discord. That is definitely the place to be. And we do have a little merch shop available on our website, so which is betwixt.com/shop. I believe that should be it. But yeah, all the links are in the description. And with that, we will sign off here, and we will see you all in the next one.
Bye,
everyone.
Please.